Yes.
The question is, where are our students going? And I will tell you, if the question refers to the animal science program, my answer is, it's split among schools of veterinary medicine. We're very successful. I'll come back and I'll tell you the statistics on that in a moment. New Jersey is the home of most of the pharmaceutical companies in the world, and there are tremendous employment opportunity for our students in pharma, as we say. And so quite a few of our students end up going into pharma on the science side, and part of our program has been tailored to give them, to require these students to take a number of business courses as well. And we've had a number of students who have moved from the lab into the administration, into the business side of that of the corporate world. Other areas include certainly we have a broad and deep body of students interested in horses, and horse breeding, equine farms continues to employ a number of our students, and some of the other areas where our students get involved then spread out from there, because we do recognize that our students have to have a broad training in business areas. So we do quite well. Most of our students get employed within just a few months of graduation in the discipline. So we're very excited about that. This year we had, regarding the vet school applications, we had, as far as we can, we polled the faculty who write letters of recommendation to find out who did you write a letter for. So we have a pretty good comprehensive list of those students in animal science graduating in 2011 that applied for vet school and will be starting in the fall. We know of 21 who applied. 20 will be starting vet school in the fall, and the one who's not going to vet school chose instead to go to the graduate program of business here at Rutgers. So we have nearly 100%. When we look at multi-year records for coming out of our program, if you look at a two-year period, that is within 2 years of graduating from our animal science program, every animal science student who applies finds placement in a vet school somewhere in the country. So it's actually an interesting paradox regarding our not having a vet school in New Jersey. As a New Jersey resident, you're a viable candidate to a vet school anywhere in the country. A New York resident is viewed by most of the vet schools around the country as someone who ought to go to Cornell, because New York has it, because most of the vet schools are state supported institutions. So while we don't have the vet school, the doors are wide open for New Jersey residents. Moreover, because of the tuition differential, that is, a New Jersey resident pays a considerably higher tuition to go to vet school in Pennsylvania or Massachusetts or Ohio. They like us because we pay more to go to school. So we do quite well. Our students get employed in a range of areas, and sometimes we're surprised that it ends up in just a few years far afield of the original. Now, I might say within the pharmaceutical industry, having been here for 22 years now, many of my former students are the employers of my current students, and that's a really nice feeling to call a former student and say, hey, here's one of your fellow alum applying for a job. And so they refer to themselves, despite our new name, as the cookies in many of these companies in New Jersey. Question is, what's on the horizon in our field of genetic engineering of food animals? You know, we've been genetically engineering food animals for nearly 10,000 years, but we did it a little slow. We did it the old-fashioned way for many, many years. Through selective breeding for animals that contain traits. And technology now has enabled us to manipulate the genes a little bit quicker, to move genes from one organism to another with all sorts of technologies. And where this stands now, it moves very slowly because of fear. Not that there are any real identified threats associated with health to people from eating food, but there's a perception that genetically engineered organisms, whether it's corn or a cow or a pig, frightens people. And so in some of these areas, we move very slowly. Areas where we may be moving much more quickly in terms of genetic engineering in food animals is in some of these studies that relate to human medicine. in breeding animals that can provide certain tissues that then can be used for skin transplants for burn victims, corneal transplants, the aorta, the valve, the heart valves. So more on the using the food animal, because we have so much history, we have so much background about their genetic information, but using them in a biomedical model rather than as a food source will likely take make faster advances than the food per se, where we'll then have to deal with those in the community who are frightened by change, and then begin will look for stories, true or not, to impede progress in that direction. That's a great question, David. So David's question was, I was in research and teaching and then moved into the extension area, and the question is, as I'm out in the field, how well does the community accept the observations, the data, the findings from the research labs? And did that paraphrase you? They seek us out. So let me tell you a little story about New Jersey agriculturalists. You know, we have the best, I have a lot of pride in New Jersey and Rutgers, but also in our farmers, and I'll tell you why. We're not the biggest farms. You know, there are individual farms in California that are you know, the size of New Jersey. And so in terms of total agricultural output in New Jersey, you know, we're not on the radar screen. But let's look at it the way it really counts. What's the economic activity on New Jersey farms per acre? How productive are we? Anybody have any idea how we might rank in the United States? All right, it's on my first hand. We're third in the country in the value of our products per acre. Yeah, we don't have a whole lot of acres compared to Nebraska and Iowa and California, but we're very productive. Why we're productive is that our producers are growing high-value products, and they're innovative. They're prepared to invest, and they're prepared to seek out advice not only from Rutgers, but from all of the land-grant universities to try to adopt new practices, innovative practices, more efficient practices to survive in agriculture in New Jersey, because it's not easy here. It's very expensive to remain in agriculture in New Jersey, which means you have to be good at it. And we have some of the smartest farmers in the country here in New Jersey. I'd like to think because they're educated here. Some of them, not all of them. We'd like to grow that program so we can educate now the sons and daughters of those who remain in agriculture. And we're seeing that happening. Small community farmers are cropping up to try to meet the need for local food production. So David, yes, I think they're very open. We have a very close working relationship with folks in the Department of Agriculture and the New Jersey Farm Bureau and the producers around the state, where they want to know, they ask the same question we heard before: what can we do to help build the ranks of faculty in the New Jersey Ag Experiment Station so that you can remain, so that you can survive for the future? So again, another reason why I take great pride in this place. Thank you.
Larry, thank you so much.